Don Siegel's 1956 Invasion of the Body Snatchers spawned a number of remakes and duplicates, shall we say. Tell us more about this, Rick.
I think it's without question that Don Siegel's original film, Invasion of the Body Snatchers, it comes from a novel by a gentleman named Jack Finney, 1954. So Siegel's, it was a popularized, serialized novel, you know, the way they used to do in Reader's Digest, if anybody even remembers that little magazine, or early literature, literature in basically serialized literature, you know, a little bit here, a little bit there every month. Every month was like an episode of a story as it was being told. And this story was Invasion of the Body Snatchers, originally called The Body Snatchers. And Don Siegel was brought on board after a couple other directors who didn't exactly work out. Siegel was brought on to flesh it out. At this point, Siegel had been established as a director, but he had been an assistant director, an editor. He famously put together the montage sequences in Casablanca. So he had a name for himself, but he wasn't. It's very strange. Siegel would never be at the top of anybody's list of the great directors, and yet so many people cite his work as basically lean, mean filmmaking. Clint Eastwood definitely owes a great deal of his career to Siegel, not just for Dirty Harry, but for, I think they made something like 6 or 7 films together: The Beguiled, Two Meals for Sister Sarah, Coogan's Bluff, Dirty Harry, and Escape from Alcatraz. So there was, you know, there was a partnership there, and you can see a lot of what Siegel did in the work of Clint Eastwood, where it's just, you know, set up, shoot it, move on. And whereas Eastwood would do it because of efficiency, Siegel was doing it because he had no other choice, because the money wasn't there. He wasn't an A-list director. He was considered more of a B-list director, or he was down the line somewhere. But he brought a kind of tough, natural quality to his films. If you watch this, Dirty Harry, one of my favorite films, Charlie Varick with Walter Matthau, you'll see the efficiency that Don Siegel brought to a project and his ability to make it really... he filled out a lot with very little. So, and I think you see that with a 20-day shooting schedule and a $345,000 budget, as you see in this film. This is exceptional film work. Now, when you watch it, it is dated. There is a great deal of it that is kind of hokey. There's a love story that's kind of crammed in there that is, I think, better realized in Philip Kaufman's 1978 version, and even in Abel Ferrara's 1993 version. As far as the 2000 and some odd version with Nicole Kidman and Daniel Craig, I don't know. I haven't seen that film. But I think the core of what this story is the paranoia and the uncertainty that whatever we think we know is in fact completely different from what we believe it to be. That's the power of this film. The very fact that we're not sure that what is around us is the truth. So I'm interested in your take, primarily because I thought you had seen this film. This was when we were doing our decade series. I listed this as the film that really defined the 1950s. We're going to get into that, and we're going to talk a little bit about that, about how that's that's both true, but also unintentional to a degree. So, what did you know about this film? What was your reaction to it, and how do you feel about both versions?
I knew the I'd seen clips of the original. Mm-hmm. I had seen some clips of the 78. Rewatching. So the process was for this, it's I watched the 78 version, the Kaufman version.
Mm-hmm.
Then I watched the original. And having watched the original, then I'm like, well, I had already seen most of the original. I didn't know how much I hadn't seen.
It's really interesting that there are certain films that whether you have seen them or you haven't seen them, you've actually seen them. You've pieced it together like a puzzle because it's this film is really part of the culture. This is a film that's quoted, it's excerpted, it's talked about. So regardless of if you know anything about films, you pretty much have seen this film in small pieces, even if you've never sat down and watched the entire film.
It's to the level of like the other day you were like, how have you not seen this, the original? Yeah. And I'm like, I haven't. And then I was watching it and I was like, I think I have seen this.
Well, you know what? What's interesting is that so much of it is reflected in Rod Serling's series, The Twilight Zone. I mean, there's a lot of the paranoia there. So it's like, you have seen it. Even if you haven't seen it, you've seen this movie.
Well, yeah. And then it's kind of like, then I'm thinking like, I'm going back and I'm questioning like whether I've in the past said that I've seen it. And have I really seen it?
You know what I mean? Like, when we talked about it for the 1950s, I think you said you had seen it. I think you were surprised at my choice.
Maybe
you were
like,
I wish I had thought about that.
But I don't. My latest fabricated fucking like memory or whatever mm-hmm. is that I had seen clips of it, but it felt like, having watched it, it felt like I had already seen it, but maybe it was just one of those things when you're like with your friends, like that thing, which happened when I was a teenager, that was like often that it would be on. And sometimes depending on what was happening around, like if it was like me and like one of my best friends, it was like, no, we were going to watch this movie. But if it was like some other extended people around, then it's kind of like, or you know, a girl or whatever, then it's like, well, I'm going to watch the movie maybe. Yeah. So that's that. But I didn't see the Abel Ferrara version. Yeah. And I definitely didn't see Invasion, the Daniel Craig, Nicole Kidman version.
Yeah. I don't think anybody saw that film. And I don't think anybody saw Abel Ferrara's film either, even though.
But at the same time, it's kind of like Abel Ferrara is okay. Like that one, I think there's wiggle room. But the Nicole Kidman, Daniel Craig, the Hirschbiegel film, I'm like, not literally, but I think we have seen it. You know what I mean? Because I think we've seen, number one, having seen the original and the Kaufman remake.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably close enough to it that we can say, yeah, I've seen it. I know it. Whatever differences there are in the 2000 version, those differences exist in tons of other films. The style exists in tons of other films of this our contemporary time period. It's one of those, to me, I'm sure, and if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. I don't think this is something that's a tour. Fucking this person's bringing his vision to it, and it's so separate from everything else. It just looks like when you go to the fast food place, you order the number 3, you expect it to come out as a number 3. And for it to taste like a number 3, to look like a number 3, the only difference is maybe the price went up. That's what you're going to fucking get. It's canned.
Well, I think when you have something of this, when you have a story of this type and this level of paranoia and mistrust of basically the government and everything around you, because that's an element of it as well. I think it's not served well by being a major studio production. Now, if you look at Abel Ferrara's film, and I wish you had seen that film, but you'll see it in the future, and maybe we'll talk about it. Number one, that's the one and only time that Abel Ferrara has ever worked in the studio system. He was working for Warner Brothers at that time. And that's 93. That was shortly after Bad Lieutenant. And I'm not sure why Warner Brothers would take a chance on Abel Ferrara. Knowing Abel Ferrara's history, knowing the volatility, drug use, drug abuse, alcohol, you know, all of those factors, as well as being New York independent filmmaker, more so than just about anybody, to give him a project like that would seem very short-sighted on the side of a studio. I gotta be honest about that. And yet his film delivers the most tension. It's weird because all three of these films, we're not talking about the 2000 version because obviously neither you or I have seen it. But these three films are very different handlings of the material.
Yeah.
And I cannot tell you which one I think is the best. I can't say which one, because each one of them does something better than the other. The Don Siegel. Okay, well, let's get into that. The Don Siegel version. Okay, first of all, let's just go into the obvious. Philip Kaufman's version, 1 hour 55 minutes. Abel Ferrara's version, 97 minutes. I think Don Siegel's 80 minutes. Kaufman really expands this world, and it's like a slow simmer. It's a very meditative piece where it's there's not a lot happening in a lot of scenes, and it's an antsy film because you kind of want something to happen. And I had never seen it until preparing for this episode, and I watched it. I think it was Wednesday. I tried to watch it at night. I couldn't. I woke up early. I watched it Thursday morning, and then I watched it again yesterday. I definitely liked it more the second time because I knew that I needed to be more patient with it. I was very impatient with the first viewing because I wanted it to move. I wanted it to move faster. I was angst-ridden with it because there is an argument that you can make where the movies that we watch today, probably from the early 2000s on, move at a faster pace. Everything since MTV.
I don't think that's even an argument. I mean, I think that's what it is.
Well, I don't like to just. Sometimes I like to be a little bit. I'll play those cards a little bit closer to the vest. But yes, well, this much I'll say, I don't want to admit that it affects me.
I see.
Which is different. Which is different.
Now we're getting somewhere.
Yeah. I know it exists. I know that music videos and especially now with TikTok and all this other bullshit, these 7 minute, 7 second, boom, you know, these stories of told like that. Like that. That's disheartening. I think it makes for bad art. When you don't have the time to really contemplate something, and what Kaufman does is very much in the spirit of allowing the story to unfold and pushing you as a viewer to be as angst-ridden as the people that he is portraying on screen.
Not to mention, and this is also, I'm going to go into my love it or not love it or leave it, but the opposite of which is the critiquing American culture. We're not we want the Henry Ford McDonald's or yeah. Henry Ford slash comma semicolon whatever McDonald's fucking fast food model. We want the assembly line model, which is like churn them out, consume, churn them out, buy, consume. We want that.
Yeah.
We don't want to like to go sit and to go to a museum and sit and look at this thing that isn't moving and to contemplate or to read a fucking book. God fucking forbid. It's probably to read a long book. Or to the longest pieces of media that I think most people consume nowadays are like Game of Thrones, these shows,
yeah.
but they're episodic.
Mm-hmm.
Even though these people are, you know, all of us, we're watching fucking 10 hours because we're binging.
Yeah, but you're being tricked into that.
We're being tricked into it.
Yeah.
And it's broken up.
Mm-hmm.
We always have that out. Like, yeah. I know I have to go to work at, you know, 8 a.m. and it's 6 in the morning and I haven't slept, but we can fit one more episode. You down?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, yeah. Like, that.
That's exactly what we do.
And I personally, look, I grew up with MTV. So I like that. I like fast images and all that stuff, but I also love slow cinema. And I also like, I don't know if that's just, if I trained myself, I don't know how that happened. I don't know how that, like, that conflict is able to exist, how those two things are able to coexist. But you have to, one has to learn to consume different types of media in a different way. You have to switch gears
mm-hmm.
And kind of, Tarkovsky is going to be different than Oliver Stone.
Absolutely.
And you have to understand that. And, you know, if you're sitting and you have to sit and chew your fucking food and enjoy it and smell it,
mm-hmm.
taste it. Don't just shovel it in your mouth, swallow it, and get in your car and fucking live a little.
Well, this is the thing with these films is that each director is not wasting the viewer's time. Don Siegel's film is quick, to the point. It paints this picture. It gives you this idea of this small town in probably Northern or Central California, whatever. Small town America. And he brings this threat into that because he knows what Americana is. He knows that this is something that's going to really attack the sensibilities of an audience. If it can happen here, it can happen anywhere. And we all need to beware. Siegel is unwilling to really... He's not gonna let anything marinate. He's right to the point. And I like that about his lean... It's lean, mean filmmaking. He had a film to make. He needed to make it. It was going to be on a double bill. It's professionalism. He's artistic, but he was artistic in the sense of filmmakers of that generation where you would ask John Ford, are you an artist? Ah, get the fuck out of here with that artist bullshit. I'm a filmmaker. I make westerns.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, I mean,
they would downplay their shit, you know?
Because that's their value system. That's their aesthetic.
Mm-hmm.
For example, if you say, you say a Tarkovsky, or you say some French, you say Godard, and you say, mm-hmm. well, that some people, particularly Americans or so-called even more Western, the Anglo world will say, some British director will say, that's so pretentious, these fucking French directors, mm-hmm. right? The French director will consider himself an artist.
Yeah.
Because he's going to say, well, I'm not fucking, like, I'm not building a car. I'm making a film. Those are different things. I'm creating something. I'm creating a work of art. The American director, especially at that period of time, is going to see that as like probably even especially at that time period on some level effeminate to say you're an artist or something like that. It's like, no, you have to be macho. It's like, no, I'm building something. Or even the Hitchcock is like, it's not about artistry. It's more, the closest that they'll get to it is to maybe consider it a craft. And say, look, like, all I have to do is diagram how everything's going to be. And then you just show up, film it, and go home. I mean, Eastwood falls into that. Hitchcock fell into that kind of that style. So it's also definitely an aesthetic. But I mean, like, that's just as pretentious as to be like, wow, this artist bullshit. I'm a filmmaker. You know, if you're chomping on a cigar, wearing an eye patch, whatever filmmaker, drinking your whiskey in the director's chair, smoke, whatever. They're all artists. It's just how they view themselves within that world and within their times, the way that these films sit within their times.
Well, that's the thing, you know, cinema is art. So if you are directing cinema, you are an artist. Whether you want to embrace that tome, that label or not, you're an artist. But there are artists that are more, I guess, practiced or
also strict, trained. Yeah.
Yeah. Instead of grand, expansive images and more artistically showy, I guess is, I don't know, or the, it's more action than anything. It's very difficult to explain.
What we're touching on is, and it seems like we're veering away, but we're always building. We're artists. Mm-hmm. I'm not a fucking. I'm not going to sit here and say like, ah, I'm doing a film podcast. This is not an art. No, this is an art form. Yeah. We're getting also into levels of. On one side, you're gonna have people who are, they're thinking about what they do as an art form, and their approach to it is the approach of expression, using film and using the language of film in a way that's different from, for example, Peter Greenaway. Are you familiar with Peter Greenaway's films?
Yeah.
Versus David Mamet. Mm-hmm. They're on completely opposite sides. David Mamet says everything is action and everything is plot and it's a text-based cinema. Peter Greenaway is a visualist and he believes in the philosophy of an image-based cinema. His thing is like all of fucking cinema has been text based since its inception. We've become obsessed with this idea that film has to tell a story. How can we go beyond that? Why would people not go beyond this? And for the majority of filmmakers and film viewers, we are married to this idea of the story, the plot, the text, at the expense of going beyond that, right? There are people who do, you know, somewhere in the middle, but it starts with a script. That's the text. That's how you get the funding. And that's where you go. whatever is not text-based cinema typically gets viewed as pretentious, all style, blah, 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 blah. Something more mammoth is it's the plot, it's all action, it's all, and that goes into the philosophy of how we view films, how we consume films, how we make them, how we fund them, how we direct them. So for the original Body Snatchers, it's like Don Siegel's of that generation, especially if you're not, and if you don't have this like crazy budget, are you going at it like a Jodorowsky, who is, he would say, I'm a warrior, I'm not even an artist, I'm a fucking spiritual warrior, versus the fucking Clint Eastwood, who's going to be in that tradition. Yeah. Kaufman is pushing the boundaries because it's also like, this is the 70s, so he can go a little bit further.
Well, he can go deeper into what society is. And it's like, you know, a lot has been said of the underlying tones and meanings of this movie. Of course, the Siegel film is notoriously parallel to McCarthyism and the Red Scare. And in interviews, both the writer of the film and Don Siegel both said, we had no intention of doing that. And I believe them. I believe that there is no statement there about communism or McCarthyism. It's a fact of life that McCarthyism and communism and the fear of communism in this country is reflected in a story like this. So rather than build from that idea, the reality of those two situations inform what is on that screen. Because if you look at it correctly, you could look at Body Snatchers, the first film, as either an endorsement of the fear or a warning to the fear. How are you reading that, you know?
The correctly part of your statement kind of like ruffles my feathers, but...
Which one?
When you said if you read it correctly...
Did I say correctly? Or no.
That's what I thought you said.
I don't think I said... I definitely didn't mean that. If you read it... I'd have to listen to it, but...
You can, but what you're getting at is
one,
like,
or yeah, there is, yes, no, there is no one. Ways. Yeah, you could read it both ways, and you can use that reading to bolster your argument on the 1950s. Way. Yeah, it's not a correct reading. I mean, there is no. I don't know if there is any correct.
No, of course.
Reading for a film.
That's why I was kind of like, well, but okay, so then. Now, having said that, let's, you know, so many times we assume that these people know what we're fucking talking about. What is the premise?
The premise of both films is in one small town, America, in the other big city, San Francisco, and in the third film, a military base, there is a sudden wave of uncertainty and paranoia that's gripping the community, and people are fearful. People are going to their doctor. In this case, Kevin McCarthy in the Don Siegel film, and saying that I don't understand, but whoever this person is, you know, my mother, my uncle, my wife, my husband, my father, they are not them. Yes, they look like them. They sound like them, they act like them, but there is something missing. And that's a brilliant jumping off point, because so many of us, you only know so much about another person, and you only know them to the degree to which they want you to know about them. In some cases, they let on too much. In some cases, they don't let on enough. But it really is... It's a questionable and questioning reading of another person. And as it turns out, these fears are validated because aliens have landed and are consuming the population and are slowly taking over and becoming us, at least in appearance, taking over bodies.
They're duplicating each person.
Reminds me of Carpenter's The Thing. So
yeah, definitely.
There's that aspect of it as well. So it's this fear of whatever you think your life is, isn't necessarily true. So it's the paranoia of the uncertainty, but it's also the slow realization that maybe you're going crazy. Because how do other people not realize this? And right. When everybody's telling you that you're mistaken, everybody's telling you that you are not reading this correctly, that your paranoia is coming out of an unfounded place. That is your father. Look at him. That's him. He knows your history. He remembers things. But there's something slightly off. And I think a lot of us
that's have, crazy.
Yeah. It's
scary.
It's, you can't put a finger on it. You can't figure out. But you know, and I know, and I think we've always been there where we're like, there's something not right about this situation in life. It's usually
something's
fucking up. You know.
Well, you know. Yeah. When you look at yourself in the mirror and you're like, I'm not who I am. I'm not who I am anymore.
Yeah. I've changed.
When you're putting on your work clothes, you know?
Yeah.
For the Red Scare, it's like, yeah, it can be read either way. It can be the communists are turning people. You know, this, you never know who's going to be turned by this, you know, alien godless ideology, right? That is communism. And still, they're fucking talking about that today. You know what I mean? The our schools are turning people into socialists.
Mm-hmm. And gay.
Of course.
And gay. Gay socialists. And
gay. Gay socialists, postmodernists, transsexual Satanists. You know, so make your room. You know, clean up your, stand up straight and clean up your fucking room. There's that. As the schools, the school is a big fucking capitalist business charging you up the ass for the rest of your fucking life, but, you know, socialism. Or two, it's like, well, these alarmist McCarthy types are turning people into other alarmists. It can go either way. And of course, either people at those extremes are going to view their position as, you know, everyone on the other side is crazy. This kind of, it was interesting looking at this suite because it reminded me of, you know, these are basically contagion type films.
Yeah.
Horror has that contagion aspect to it. The vampire, you know, originally it's like, well, not originally, but once you get to Bram Stoker, you have this threat from the east, this Eastern European threat coming to London, and is it going to change people? The vampire with werewolves, if you're bitten by a werewolf, what happens, right? Zombies, once you die, once the zombies are out and you die, you become one, or may they bite you and you become one, or whatever. The Thing, contagion. This is all contagion. And it's that paranoia of like, when someone is infected with something, you may not know that they're infected with it, and now you're afraid. So I was thinking about Romero, and I was thinking about his zombie, his Dead series. For this, you can see the original having that, the Red Scare metaphor. So the question was like, well, can you apply, if you look at all these other remakes, can you apply, number one, can you apply the same Romero Living Dead metaphor? Does each film represent a specific aspect of a culture and the time that it's made in terms of like whatever that threat is? Or is it just that the remakes, they, whatever cultural references that they have, they're just incidental?
I don't think it's as go ahead, I'm sorry.
As black or white.
No, I don't think it's as intentional as Romero. I think it's perhaps like with the Kaufman film, the 78 film, you start to look at it you're reflecting on society at that time. So you're coming out of you're coming out of the flower power movement. You're coming out of the free love period, and you're going into a more mistrustful 1980s. Once again, to beat that fucking dead horse, you're coming out of Vietnam and Watergate, the mistrustfulness of the government, the Ford administration in pardoning Nixon. We never really talked about that. I don't think we've ever really, you know.
What do you mean?
We've talked a lot about Nixon. You and I on this show. We've talked a great deal about the Nixon administration, Watergate, the impeachment, and Nixon's resignation. But we've never really talked about what it might have affected, how it might have affected the populace for the Ford administration to absolve Nixon of all of his wrongdoings. Technically, the man should have been tried. Technically, the man should have probably gone to prison. But Ford pardoned him.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, there is a level of disappointment in a great many people who say the man should have stood trial. The man should have been, what are laws if you're so rich and you're so powerful that you cannot be held accountable for something? So there was the mistrust of the government, there was Vietnam, and then there was that they would sweep under the carpet the sins of their own. They would protect themselves. And you see it now. It's not as blatant. It's not as blatant as with Nixon. It's even worse because, let's be honest, when Jeffrey Epstein died, that whole thing went away. Why was there no investigation? What am I talking about? I'm talking about there was a list of people who went to that fucking island. Why was that not investigated? Why? Because Bill Gates, Bill Clinton, Prince Andrew, and a number of other powerful, powerful people were on that charter. Shit like that goes away when somebody is giving enough to take their own life. Let's just say that. With all the innuendo and the skepticism.
Well, I mean, not fucking innuendo. That's a billboard.
Yeah. But the point of what I'm saying is that with the Kaufman film, you have a level of where in the Siegel film communism is turning people. In the Kaufman film, it's almost like we are going into this thing willingly because there is no you're going into the Reagan era. You're leaving that period of free love and self-identity and the individual.
Well, it's an interesting like moment. And look, to do a parallel to today, like you don't have to go into fucking like Epstein and conspiracy theory, or is it not conspiracy theory or whatever. It's we don't have to go look at all the shit that the issues with Trump and the impeachments and the. Sure. And then now it's like, well, now we want to impeach Biden because of this, because we have to retaliate, and it's this thing. And So not holding someone accountable, you don't have to go to the Epstein Island. That's more extreme.
But if the extreme isn't handled, how the hell is anything else going to be, you know?
Go ahead. There's shit that's in front of us that's more conclusive. Mm-hmm. About things not being, or about people not in power not being held accountable. There's a direct parallel from Nixon to Trump. There isn't a direct parallel from Nixon to Epstein.
No.
So it's like we don't have to go into left field for Epstein. We can just clearly see, like, the defenders of Donald Trump are doing what they do, regardless. And to put it back generationally to the 70s, it's like, well, look at the three films. Mm-hmm. The first one takes place in a town.
Yeah.
There is a parallel to the Living Dead series, because this first one takes place in a town. Mm-hmm. The second one takes place in a city, just like this. The second one takes place in a city. It's a metropolitan, it's a mall, whatever. Military base. Yeah. But for the second invasion of the Body Snatcher, I mean, yeah, for the remake,
Film,
the second film, the Philip Kaufman 78 film, it is in between that place, but it's not like, it is this liminal time period, because it's not like the flower power was the day before.
No.
It's 10 years before, mm-hmm. But it's still close enough that those people who were hippies have now grown up. And they've now had to look at themselves in the mirror and say, what happened?
That's the old adage of it's easy to be a hippie when you're young. You're going to sell out by the time you're 30. Because you want that comfort. Because you need that idea of security. You got to worry about back then a pension.
Or you don't sell out and you're paying for it in some way.
Yeah.
And it's San Francisco, mm-hmm. and it's the health department, and it's, after the sexual revolution, but, you know, there's all this strife, there's all this mistrust. It's before AIDS, mm-hmm. well, before it blows up. Mm. So it's kind of like before 80s Reagan, like you described.
Yeah.
It's before Gordon Gekko, Greed is Good. But it's still, it's in between. And then those of us from our generation, from Gen X, who are born in this time period, mm-hmm. or born a little bit before, but our children still, grow up with the sense of cynicism.
Yeah.
So it's not necessarily like the 50s, this idealism and consumerism, but we have supposedly this view of how the world is supposed to be. That shit is filtered through the 60s, how the world is supposed to be, and then there's a big fucking letdown because it's not. It's kind of like, how is the world, you know, the attitude is more like, well, how the fuck is the world supposed to be? How is it supposed to be? The fear of the 50s turns into, it's not the fear of in the 70s. It's in the 70s, people don't fucking care. It's like, what the fuck are you talking about?
There's a certain sense of uncertainty and unknowing of what the 80s are going to bring. you know, I brought up the Gerald Ford thing. I brought up Nixon again because it was that period of everything that we were taught to believe was wrong, was a lie. Not necessarily wrong, but a lie. There's a mistrust of everything. So there becomes a greater sense of being untrustworthy of the individual self, of being a lot of this goes back to the Matrix, where it's like you sell out to this idea in both films, not so much in the third film, but in both films, there is the mantra of the people who have been turned saying, you want this, you need this,
yeah, this
is better for you, this is good, you don't need love, you don't need hate, this is, and it's the people fighting, and like, I don't want to live in a world without that, I don't want to live in a world like that. If you ask a lot of people, I would have taken the red pill real quick. A lot of people say that. I would have taken, isn't the red pill the one that just sends you further into the Matrix?
And no, the blue pill, the red pill is the one that wakes you up.
Okay, so the blue pill, take that blue pill and go the fuck to sleep and just be happy being the slave that you need to be, because there's less, if you're not extending yourself and putting yourself out for the failure, then there's no chance for failure. There's no chance to be heartbroken. There's no chance for disappointment. And that is kind of the idea that's being preached there. And it's in both films. You have the communist backdrop of the Siegel film, whether intentional or not, it's there. With this film, you have, with the Kaufman film, I get the feeling that you have the sense of finding a greater purpose, which is to just become a cog. Now, with the Ferrara film, and you'd have to see this in order to comment, but I think it's the most obvious and I think it's the most on point, which is setting it on a military base with the conformity that is needed to join the military and be part of that world. I think that's a very blatant and obvious statement in that film, because Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, the mantra is pretty much all the same. Break down the man to build up the soldier.
Mm-hmm.
Break down the bad habits to instill the good. And in this case, it's just extreme. Because it's alien forces. It's giving up ourselves. The really troubling aspect of all these films is if you look at it correctly, if you look at it without any kind of rose-colored glasses, or if you're being honest with yourself, how many of us sell ourselves to that world of loss of individualism? That's the job. That's family. I mean, how many times have people just, you know, I don't know how many times I've heard, well, you get married, you have kids. You get married, you have kids, you get a job. That's what you do.
Well, that's also, this goes to the broader thing too, because it's like, yeah, and then we'll move into the specific to the films, but it's like, well, in the original Invasion of the Body Snatchers, it's kind of like, well, there are these fears of the erosion of the family, mm-hmm. the blah blah blah, the, right? It's already this conformist decade, so it's like, well, there's a problem with us. We're changing.
Sure.
By the time you get to the second film in the 70s, there's a greater. In Leonard Nimoy's character, because the cast it's Donald Sutherland, it's Jeff Goldblum, Leonard Nimoy, Veronica Cartwright, Brooke Adams.
Mm-hmm.
You have
and a wonderful cameo by the great Robert Duvall.
Where's Duvall?
Are you fucking kidding me?
I remember, where was Duvall?
Robert Duvall is patient zero. Robert Duvall is the priest swinging in the park. It's really creepy. It's just, you know, the woman, Brooke Adams is looking at the flowers. That's where she first discovers the pods. And that's what was great about a second viewing, is that I was picking up on all kinds of shit.
Little things
that are set up. All the flower imagery, yeah. Right? Yeah, all of that shit is there, and how it plays out later in the bigger picture of the story. I mean, a second viewing is, I think at least, very necessary in this film. But Duvall is a priest at a park swinging on just swinging. He never speaks. They never go back to him. He's just there swinging on a swing in a park as the teacher. Maybe you missed the first beginning. Maybe you got a bad copy. I don't know what the fuck you saw, but it was Duvall. And Duvall did it as a favor to Philip Kaufman. He was in San Francisco for that week, and they put him in a priest gear. He got an Eddie Bauer jacket out of the deal. He didn't take any money. It was just the ridiculousness of having Robert Duvall there. And there's something off about it. And later you realize, well, wait a minute, that's patient zero. That's the first guy that at least we meet that has been turned.
That's the first one.
Yeah. It's just something kind of not right about it. I can't believe you didn't see it.
I probably saw it, but I don't remember it.
It's very weird. If you go back and you go through the credits and you watch the first 5 minutes.
Is Don Siegel in it?
Don Siegel is the cab driver. Don Siegel is the cab driver that picks him up. Michael Chapman, the director of cinematography, he's the janitor that's sleeping on. Michael Chapman is the guy that shot the picture. He also went on to shoot.
Yeah, I don't know his face. Like,
He also went on to shoot *Raging Bull* and a couple of other Scorsese films. Maybe *Goodfellas*. I can't remember if that was Chapman or Ballhouse. But Kevin McCarthy makes a cameo appearance in it as well. The doctor from the first film. He's the one that runs into Brooke Adams and Donald Sutherland's car. They're here, they're coming, they're going to get us, they've taken over. And then he runs through the street and he gets hit by another car, remember?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I remember that.
That was Kevin McCarthy from the original film.
The main guy.
The main guy, the doctor.
Yeah, the psychiatrist.
Yeah. No, not the psychiatrist, the general practitioner. The main character in the first film. Anyway, all of this is
the main guy.
The main guy, yeah. So
Mm-hmm. Sorry, go ahead and then because we're all over the place.
No, we're all over the place. So yeah, go ahead. That was just a tangent. That was just a diet.
In the 70s, these ideas of therapies, mm-hmm. and
oh yes,
Leonard Nimoy's all these different types of pop therapies, primal scream therapy, mm-hmm. and John Lennon was into that stuff that David Cronenberg would, you know, the character that the drunken actor who's in The Brood, great
Oliver
great
Reed.
Voice, Oliver Reed.
Yes.
That's how I find. That's the clue I use for that.
The drunk actor.
It becomes, there's something, it's not, oh, there's something wrong with us, blah, blah. It's, there's something wrong with me.
Yeah.
And already you're going into the film thinking there's something wrong with you. And then now it's like, oh, then you can see this person's off.
Yeah.
The third, what is the threat? What is the, if you're looking for that metaphor, like what's the, the military base is where.
What's the basic premise? Military industrial complex, basically. I think with Ferrara, it's pretty obvious. Him being such an individualist and a somewhat of a crazy bastard.
A fuck the man kind of guy.
Exactly. You know, where there's a hopelessness. I mean, if you watch Ferrara's films and I think about it, because he's got a pretty large filmography, and I've only seen a handful of films, and I think I've disliked more than I've actually liked. But the ones that I like are incredible. Incredible films. So I think that, you know, you got to remember this is 93. So this is basically right after the Gulf War, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So yeah. Ferrara being the individualist that he is, I think he's going to have a pretty negative impression of the military and our role throughout the world. And that's what's happening. By the end of that film, the military is facilitating the growth of these pods and the taking over of society. It's the most blatant of all of the films because the military is a piece that fits so easily into that puzzle. So, you know, what was great about his film, I think his film is the most tense and nerve-wracking of all of them. Don Siegel's film was the classic. Well, Don Siegel's film was the classic. Philip Kaufman's film is the most meditative and really critical of society as a whole. They all have incredible camera work and play beautifully with shadows, especially the second film. But the third film has a tension. It has a tension and a mistrust of the family more so than any of the others, because there are no married couples in the first and second film, but at least those are not portrayed. Those are not the main drive. The main drive of the third film is a young girl, Gabrielle Anwar, from Son of a Woman and Things to Do in Denver When You're Dead. She's like 17, 18. Her father is a chemist, and they're spending a month on a military base to examine the safety of certain procedures and chemicals and stuff like that. Meg Tilly is her mother, is her stepmother at least. And already there, you're playing into the idea of somebody replacing somebody who means dearly to you. So there's that aspect of it. And the uncertainty of your teenage years and what that young girl is going through, her distaste for the stepmother, her anger at the father who has moved on, not to mention just the everyday struggles between father and daughter and you know that dynamic, but also the military now being a force that we're supposed to respect and fear, because I think fear of the military is also something that is, although it's not spoken of, it's not expanded on in society. We're supposed to look at these people as protectors. There's an underlying feeling that we need to be afraid of them, because that in effect keeps us in line. I don't think I'm too far off on that one. But
I mean, it's either people are going to view them that way, or else someone who I knew before described, yeah. He was in the military, and he described it as, he said that to them, some officer or whatever was telling them this, was describing it in this way. He said, well, society, they're the sheep.
Mm-hmm. Or the shepherds.
No. He said that they were the sheepdogs. And that out there that there were wolves.
Yeah.
And that they were what were the sheepdogs were the ones that were standing between the wolves and the sheep to protect the sheep.
Yeah.
And we're at the airport, it was in theater, and we're at the airport, and I was kind of too tired to listen to that nonsense. and so I said, well, who are the shepherds?
Yeah. You went to where and I went said, with it. Yeah. Okay.
And he said, there are no shepherds, in that story or whatever. And I'm like, yes, there are. Yes, there are. And the sheep get sheared and then slaughtered.
And how many people looked at you like you were the asshole?
No one.
No one?
Just him. Everyone knows me. They looked at me.
That doesn't
like,
stop them from
before I opened my mouth.
There you go. Well, you're an asshole. You can't say that kind of shit, especially around 9/11. You can't say that shit.
I mean, also, not the airport.
You know what I'm talking about.
But it was also where it's a group of fucking actors, yeah. And it's like, and half of them have no fucking clue.
Mm-hmm.
And then the other half, I mean, like, most of them are not going to be rah-rah-rah, sis-kumba, fucking, like, G.I. Joe shit. You know what I mean? Like,
sure.
Half of them just want to go do a show and then get drunk and late after.
Yeah.
The other half are like...
The American dream. There you go.
Right. Right. The American fucking dream. What's wrong with me? You know? So let's talk about endings. So yeah. The endings...
Well, the end... And this is another thing where Kaufman's film excels and is more... It's more artistic and it's more... It's more in keeping. Granted, the 70s, it was the end of an era. You could go with a dark, pessimistic ending like that. And I had seen that image of Donald Sutherland, but I hadn't put it together up until that point. So it was kind of fun to see how that finally played out. And the bleakness of it. The Siegel film has a studio influence. I mean, it would have been much better if Kevin McCarthy had, if the film had ended with that close up of Kevin McCarthy on the highway, cars driving past him with him screaming into the night like the madman that he has turned into, whether he wants to believe that he's insane or not. At that point, he's crazy. But reality can drive you crazy. Reality
just can take you. Paranoid doesn't mean they're not.
Doesn't mean that they're not after you. The Siegel film was compromised. Siegel talked about it. Siegel was upset about it. Siegel regretted ever shooting it. And
what did he want?
He wanted it. He did not want those bookends. He did not want. There's a sense of hope that we're going to beat this thing because they find that body in the fire and it was carrying pods and they have to pull this guy out from underneath all these pods. They've never seen anything like it. And where was it coming from?
Yeah, it confirms from Samaria. Everything that gets said. Yeah.
Exactly. And now we're going to move. And now it's Independence Day and
it's an emergency.
Blow it up. Yeah.
And
the red, white, and the blue is going to come out there and we're going to save ourselves. We're going to survive.
Yeah, we need the Avengers.
Yeah. You know, that American spirit is going to triumph.
Prevail.
Exactly. That's not what you get in the Kaufman film. The Kaufman film, everybody has become zombified. And it's the one guy that you thought you were following, you were hoping, and now he gives that fucking look. And it's crazy. And it's insane. And I love that ending. I love that
ending. So, I mean, since you saw the shot,
mm-hmm.
You had already seen that image.
That thing is notorious. The thing is that they show that in clips. You'd never seen it before?
I had seen clips of of the movie, but I hadn't seen that. So I watched it with Leslie.
Yeah.
With Miss Goodbye every time someone's about to get killed, right?
Yeah.
So she figured, and spoiler fucking alert, you guys know this already.
Absolutely. This is where we're at in this part of the show.
She figured that Sutherland's character had changed.
Mm-hmm.
So what's happening is he's... It's this ensemble of people mm-hmm. trying to escape all of these pod people. Slowly they all change. Leonard Nimoy has betrayed them.
Yeah.
Jeff Goldblum has changed. He's dead. Veronica Cartwright at one point tells them. She tells the Adams Sutherland couple if you don't show emotion, you can blend in with them. Mm-hmm. And then there's a fucking shot of a fucking of a dog with a fucking man's face. Yeah.
I love that which shot. Is it's great. I love that shot. That could go so fucking bad. And the fact that Kaufman had the balls to do that, I thought was insane. I loved it. I loved it.
Yeah, it was a nice touch. And so they didn't have the grace under pressure, as Hemingway would have put it, to just fucking keep their shit in mm-hmm. check. And so, you know, you freak out when you see a dog with a human's face. Yeah. When in the past you've seen that person with the dog in the yeah. park. And you haven't seen Robert Duvall, apparently. So then they run off, and it's almost the end of the film, and you're just like, what the fuck is, how are they going to get out of this?
Yeah.
Because you can't fall asleep.
Yeah.
If you fall asleep, a duplicate of you will emerge from this pod, and then the others will take the original you and dispose of you. And now everything that's left is the replacement. And so you cannot fall asleep. So eventually you're going to fall asleep.
Have to.
You have to. So it's like, how the fuck is this going to happen? And it keeps going and going. And then eventually, the Brooke Adams, similar to them, the first one, except in this one, she shows her breasts, because it's the 70s.
Yeah.
She changes. So he's like fucking freaking out, and now it's just him. The Cartwright character has disappeared suddenly after the dog. So now he's hiding under a dock. So they're looking for him under the dock, and one of the duplicates shines a flashlight in his direction under the dock. And then there's a cut. It cuts away. So Leslie thought that based on the grammar of it, she thought that by cutting away, and then it cuts to him walking among the others in these office spaces in the Department of Health. She took that to mean that he had already changed, because when they shine the light in his direction and they cut, and now he's in that space, he's integrated it with them. And so that by the time at the end, he meets the Veronica Cartwright character outside, they stop and look at each other. She's excited and she speaks to him. She calls out his name. He fucking throws his eyes get wide. He throws his head back. He points at her and he lets out this fucking shriek.
And it's great.
Which is the shriek that they let out when they recognize someone who hasn't been transformed yet.
Yeah.
So he fucking outs her. And she's the last one.
Yeah.
And so it ends. And it's like, well, she fucked up. Leslie thought that was inevitable. She saw it coming that way.
It could have went both ways. It could have been.
Yeah. This is what, for me, I thought the ending would be more ambiguous, with doubt as to whether he or not he had changed. So I thought that the cutaway, the pointing the flashlight in his direction and then the cutting away, I thought that that was inconclusive.
Yeah.
And I thought that it was inconclusive, and I thought that it was purposefully, it was done in a way to kind of throw you off.
Yeah.
Which either way it is, however you take it. But to me, it left doubt as to whether or not he'd been caught. And when I see him walking among in that office space, I'm thinking, well, he could have just learned to do what the Veronica Cartwright character is doing, especially you see him following the Brooke Adams character, the Elizabeth character. He looks like he's kind of like following her, yeah, but avoiding her seeing him.
Yeah.
it actually turns out that it just kind of there since there's no emotion involved, it's kind of like there's it means nothing. But to us, it means something because we already have a relationship established. This is the beauty of the ambiguity of it. Certain parts are ambiguous on purpose to lead you ultimately to where it goes. Mm-hmm. So I'm thinking he hasn't changed yet, and I'm waiting for the Veronica Cartwright character has to come back because she just disappeared. Like she has to come back. So I'm expecting either for her to have turned, or what I was really expecting, because I'm like, the movie's going to end. I'm thinking that they're going to somehow like maybe pass each other, more like the thing, like they're going to pass each other, but neither of them is going to like let on. And so you don't really know if they've changed or one of them has changed, or you have no, you're kind of like left in this like limbo.
Yeah.
That's what I expected. But no, it did surprise me because it was so conclusive. It was so utterly conclusive, so utterly hopeless.
Yeah,
that I found it refreshing.
I did too. And I think for it to have had a happy ending, for them to beat it, it wouldn't have worked. But I'm a cynic, and I like that kind of blunt. What I view as honesty about the species and where we are and what we're going to, but also when an ending is that, I'm not talking about the way it plays out as being powerful. The shot is powerful because it freaks you out. The way Sutherland commits to that moment, putting the finger out, leaning back, and then that scream. And then you cut to Veronica Cartwright just breaking down because you know it's done for. She's done. She can't get it. She's in broad daylight. There's nowhere to run, and you're tired.
Yeah, how the fuck has she been up awake all this time anyway?
How have you? And it's like, I really did think that he was playing along to get through it. And then when it was as definitive as it was, I just rejoiced. I was like, oh, that's fucking brilliant. I love it. I love that. I love that ending. And it's something that the original film doesn't have, studio imposed. And the third film doesn't hit that beauty of an ending. The third film has a decent ending, but it doesn't have. It's the third film is a little bit more ambiguous.
Mm.
So you go from happy to bleak and hopeless to ambiguous, and I think each film. I like each film for different reasons, and I can't say which is the best of the three films. Partially because I think they're all. Even though they're all based on the same source material, they're all radically different takes on the material. And I think all three of them do incredible jobs of it. Siegel, Kaufman, Ferrara. Great films. These are three really exciting. I think if you sit down and you watch them all, maybe one a night, I don't think you'll be disappointed. And when you get three like that, that hit it out of the park, I don't want to take a chance with the fourth film.
Well, this leads me to kind of like where to wrap it up in terms of the idea of remakes. Yeah. Because it's interesting that I can think of a handful of remakes that I think are really worthy.
Mm-hmm.
Remakes or different enough that they have their own personality. You know, I want the auteur theory. I want personality. I understand that cinema is collaborative. I get that. But I want to see the personality, the stamp, the vision of a director on that film. John Carpenter's The Thing.
Definitely different, yeah.
That I think that's one of the greatest, if not the greatest, remake. Herzog's Nosferatu the Vampire.
Yes.
Whatever you think of the of that film, I think it's a different enough remake, and it has his stamp. Scarface, De Palma, different enough and has the stamp. Fistful of Dollars, different enough and has the stamp. Sorcerer, different enough and has the stamp. Even Bram Stoker's Dracula, different enough and has the stamp. Regardless of how, again, how, whatever you think of it, whatever, I don't care. Like, for me right now, it's like, is it, does it, can it exist on its own?
Yeah.
Not is it better than the original, not is it different. Bram Stoker's Dracula is different from Todd Browning's Dracula, and it has its own moments, it has its own personality. This, the second one, is the same. I highly doubt that the fucking 2007 version of this is its own fucking thing. I think it's I'm sure it's fucking, it's just a fact, it's a pod fucking film.
Just the fact
it's a facsimile that's missing something.
Just the fact of Nicole Kidman and Daniel Craig, who I both have liked in other films, in this property from a major studio with that much money backing it, there was going to be no way with a first time, not a first time director, but a first American, a first time a foreign director shooting here, that was going to be a compromised film, and I doubt that it was able to have the power and the individuality in the filmmaking, in, you know, these are definitely auteur films. I think these are very much films of their makers, and I think we benefit from it because you have a distinct look, you have a distinct handling of the material, and that's why for me they're three complete. They're very similar. The foundation is the same. But these are completely different films. They stand on their own. They're their own things. And they're brilliant in that aspect. They're all much different handlings of the material. I recommend that I recommend that you watch them in order. I think you need to watch the original film, then the Kaufman film, and then throw in the Abel Ferrara film. Abel Ferrara film is it's going to be the least accessible, and it's still, I think it's still an exceptional film. Watch it. Take a look. Let us know what you think. At this point, we want to just let people know that, yeah, we are still soliciting. We are still asking for your assistance in helping out. So if you like the show, if you like what we do, you know what? Dig into those pockets and go to buymeacoffee.com/watchrickramos. Donate whatever you can. And I will tell you this, it is appreciated on both of our parts. We bust our ass for this thing. The least you can do is throw a couple of fucking dollars our way to show some kind of appreciation. This is not a matter of, we're not trying to guilt anybody into anything, but it would be nice. So if you can,
I'm going to put Sally Struthers out here to adopt you. If anyone's old enough to know what I mean.
If anybody Ben, remembers the 80s.
I want to thank Ben for adopting Rick for a month.
Oh, that's nice.
Yes, Ben is your new patron.
Beautiful. Thank you, Ben.
So, Father Ben.
We hope you like what you were doing. We thank you for your generosity. All right, ladies and gentlemen, that's the episode. We hope to talk to you again next week as we continue horror. Bye-bye now.